be on it. It's a narrow road, but the mercy's wide, 'cause you're good on your promise.
Come on,
I'll take you at your word. If you say chaos fell in line, and I know, 'cause I've seen it in my life.
It's a narrow road.
It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on it. It's a narrow road and the tide is high, but you're part of the water. Your grace is always enough, and you said your heart would never forget or forsake me. And you said I'm saved, and you called me yours. You said my future's full of your hope, and you never fail. So I know that.
You are Hi, I'm Zach, and welcome to Dwelling Place Church. We're so happy you decided to join us today. We have just a few announcements for you. First, DP Kids Water Day is coming up on Saturday, June 8th from 10:30 a.m. until 1 p.m. at the Cherokee Aquatic Center in Woodstock. Join us for a fun day in the water. You can sign up at the Next Steps table today or on the Church Center app. The cost is $5 per person and includes pizza and drinks for the kids. One parent must attend. Second, ladies, listen up. We have DP Ladies Night coming up on Friday, June 21st from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. This will take place at the Edgewater Subdivision Clubhouse in Holly Springs. Be sure to bring an appetizer along with the notes to your favorite 30-minute recipe to share with others. Everyone will swap recipes on note cards for you to take home and try with your family, and you'll learn how to make a good loaf of sourdough bread. Invite a friend and be a part of this fun night of fellowship with the ladies. There's no need to sign up, just join us. Well, that's all the announcements we have for you today. Have an incredible Sunday.
Very good. So everybody say this Saturday. We got DP Kids Water Day. Anybody excited about that over to my right? There we go. I got one. That's it. That's it. That's it. Dance it out, bro. Dance it out. So DP Kids Water Day this Saturday. It's going to be a great, great time for all of our kiddos. And then in a couple weeks on a Friday, this is not only going to minister to the ladies, but the ladies who attend who are married, it's going to minister to their husbands too, because they're going to get sourdough bread for the whole month of July. And so they're going to get better and better. No, ladies, seriously, this is DP Ladies Night. This is going to be a great, great time for ladies. And it's, again, coming up on the 21st from 6:30 to 8:30. And then this month, we're kicking off a new series today called Dinner with Jesus. And just want to encourage you over the next few weeks just to open your heart wide to what God wants to do and how He wants to challenge you to put into practice His Word. And we're going to give you more and more details about the challenge for the congregation in the month of June. We'll talk a little bit about it today in the sermon, but then also next Sunday as well. Why don't we stand together and let's go back into a time of worship as the team just serves us and leads us. God, we thank You for Your presence. Lord, we thank You that, Lord, on the wings of praise, Lord, You recommunicate Your presence to us. And I pray today You'd minister to every heart in Jesus' name. Let's worship together.
Things like You do, God, I look to You. You're where my help. this morning. There is power in the name of Jesus. And so this morning we just say your name with authority. We say Jesus. Lord, over every struggle, over every victory, we just proclaim the name of Jesus this morning.
Adonai, Elohim, great I am, lives in me, El Shaddai.
Searchable for the Lord to search it again and again. That no matter how long you follow Jesus, your heart stays tender to allow the Lord to search me, O God. Reveal to me anything that's unlike you. And just like I preached on this stage last Sunday, God would speak to you this week. God really dealt with me this week. One morning I woke up very early and the Lord just clearly spoke to me as clear as day and said, Craig, I want to search your heart. And I said, Lord, yes, search my heart. And that opened up layer of the Lord just showing me areas of my heart that are unlike Him. Attitudes and judgments of my heart that are unlike Him. And it led me to weeping and repenting and saying, God, if there be anything faulty way in me, rid me. And listen to me, church. I want to tell you something as your pastor. I want to tell you something really clearly. I don't sense anything in this summer where Pastor Chad and I are having to get up on stage and through the Word of God rebuke, reprove, or bring correction. I really don't feel that in this season, though there are seasons like that that pastors have to do that. But I'm going to tell you what the Lord told me when He was dealing with my heart this week, is that God wants to search our hearts, because many people in our church, they've just lost focus. And maybe you're in here today and you've lost focus. Focus on what really matters. Focus on the fact that God wants this place to be a place of restoration. And where God really began to burden my heart this week, it is as we prepare for this next season of ministry that won't be in this facility, but in a facility down the road, that God would make that place a place of restoration. People who are deeply broken would come and find restoration, not only for their life, but their marriages. The hopes and dreams and brokenness would find substance in God's presence. And I don't know about you, but maybe you've gotten to a place where you've lost some focus. Maybe you've put too much hope in a political reality coming this November that's going to dash your dreams once again. Maybe you've lost focus. Maybe you've lost focus because you're looking to something to the left or right that's going to give you satisfaction. And I'm going to tell you, God is using this season, and I believe this summer, to get our focus back on what He desires. And I just wanted to ask you, if you would, this afternoon, would you have enough boldness to just maybe open up your heart for a moment and just ask the Lord to search you? As even the Word of God gets ministered today, just ask the Holy Spirit to search you, and He will. The lamp of the Lord will search you, and He will place, and He will highlight areas that need to go. And then you just quickly, through repentance, just say, respond, and say, God, rid me. Let Your blood cover me again. Would you right now just open up your heart with me? God, we ask, Holy Spirit, that You would search us. That, Lord, in a glimpse of Your glory, our lives are seen in Your light. And that, God, You would purge us of anything that's unlike You. Wrong attitudes, wrong objectives, wrong ideas, wrong motives, God. That You would purge us. False hopes, false ideas, God. That You by Your Spirit would shine light into our hearts. And, Lord, if there's any of us, Lord, begin with me, that need quickly be led to repentance. Lord, let us be led unto repentance. And Lord, let times of refreshing come. Some of you, maybe you feel the conviction of the Spirit this morning. I want you just to say, God, cleanse me. Lord, let Your blood cleanse me. Lord, do a fresh work in me, God. Realign my priorities. Realign my focus. Realign my eyesight, God, to see You. Lord, that You would allow my heart to be cleansed, God. Lord, that I would long only to see Your glory and Your kingdom, Lord, be advanced in and through my life, my work, my family, my hands, my efforts, God. Search us, O God. See if there be any unclean way in us, O God. You said, who may ascend the hill of the Lord? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, God, cleanse us. We pray, cleanse us. May the blood of Jesus and the light of Your glory, God, shine in our hearts. Make us sensitive, Lord. Keep us sensitive to Your work. Lord, we pray this in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. Lord, we thank You for Your power. I thank You for Your presence that's here this afternoon. Lord, help us to maintain focus. It's one of our core values as a church, maintaining focus. And that's what the Lord spoke to me early in the morning. That this is a season of maintaining and re-clarifying focus. So, Lord, as a congregation, Lord, our focus is on You. What do You want us to do? How do You want us to live? What way do You want us to proceed? We welcome Your great wisdom, wisdom from above. In Jesus' mighty name. And all of God's children said, amen. You may be seated in God's presence. Thank you, worship team, for leading. This time, I'm going to invite those who went to Africa with us last week. We got back last week. I want to invite you up to the stage, and we're going to take a few moments to let you get to hear from a few short reflections of those who went to our trip, our mission trip to Africa, and then we're going to recognize some graduates before the Word of God comes today. But I want you to put your hands together for those that went to Africa, and they're going to come. Pastor King, Jessica, yeah, come on up here, guys, ladies. So this trip was an amazing, amazing trip. You're going to see some visual support on the screens behind me. And each of them, I've asked just to share a little snippet of what God did in their heart. I want to thank you as a congregation for your great investment and commitment, because as an extension of Dwelling Place Church, we were able to minister to about 50 couples, so over 100 folks at a marriage seminar all weekend long. And it was an uphill battle from the outset in ministry and effectiveness and language barriers. And then these leading connect groups and got to lead breakout sessions. And they got to lead a prayer labyrinth, which is a essentially praying with your body through the community of Gombani. It was a beautiful thing to see, and just an amazing, amazing trip. And so I'm just going to let each of them, I'm going to start down here with my man Casey Duck, and he's going to share just a little bit about what did God do in your life in the trip?
Yeah, so I lost my voice when I got back, sorry. But it was great. Here, there's a picture of us at Iris, just being able to love on the orphans. And God just broke my heart for these little guys. And I think because I have three little guys of my own, so I just, got to picture them in that situation. So my heart just really broke for them. Also, I got to be on the trip with my father. There's a picture of us at the airport there. So it was really sweet moments, get to minister with my father, but also my heavenly father. But what stuck out the most is just our vulnerability. Like Pastor said, we got to do small groups, we got to do breakout sessions, and they haven't really done those before, so we didn't know what to expect. And there was a hardness at the beginning, but we just kept pressing, and we kept pressing, we kept pressing. And each time, they began to open up more and more and more. And just the vulnerability that they had, it was really touching. And the men were really engaging. And I could sense that they really just wanted to be pleasing in their marriages and honor the Lord. So it was just a beautiful moment to see that.
Hey, good afternoon, family. So I think overall, if I had to say a word, the trip was super special. First, I think just like Casey mentioned, just ministering God's vision and value for marriage. I mean, just seeing couples pray together like that, I was like, Lord, that trip of 16 hours, that was rough, that was worth it. Just to see, couples united and rekindle communication, and so that was special. But one part of the trip we spent, me and Pastor Craig spent I'm not exaggerating, 8 hours nonstop playing with children, and just seeing Jesus through their smiles and their laughs was like a whole nother part of Lord, that was really special. We had dinner with the family, and just to check out, no responsibilities, and really focus on, hey, I'm gonna love these people in front of me. And I feel like the Lord enlarged my heart for these people. Like ever since I got back, it's been a daily prayer of, I'm going to pray for these people, specifically the community in Gombani. So really special trip. And I'm like, Lord, I don't know what you want to do next, but my wife's like, maybe I held the fort for 10 days. I don't know if I could do it every year, but the Lord's doing something there. So I'm excited to see. And overall, it was super special. I know there's a trip, a picture over there of a lion. So in the last part of the trip, we went to Kruger National Park, and Pastor Guy's like, dude, it's going to be intense. And I was like, yeah, I'm not a big animal guy, but once I locked eyes with that lion, it was over. I mean, I'm not exaggerating. It was about less than 10 feet from us, and I locked eyes, and I just felt the majesty of the Lord, and it was just special. So that was another cool part of the trip that was life-giving and just a lot of memories. So thanks for praying for us. We definitely pray our prayers.
This was my sixth missions trip, but I haven't been in 10 years, so it kind of felt like brand new. But it was just an amazing time of coming from a year of kind of brokenness in my personal life and going through what I went through, and then it being a marriage retreat, I was kind of like, Lord, what are you doing? What are you doing here? But he really just showed me redemption every day I woke up, and I could just see his redeeming love. And I loved every moment of this trip, but what stood out to me was definitely the breakout sessions and the marriage conference. The first one, Vadim and I led together, and it was very combative, and there was a lot of tension. And by the last day, they were standing and thanking us and telling us they had learned so much. There were things in the Bible that they had never heard about marriage, particularly the men saying that they didn't know that this was the way they were supposed to love their wives. Thank you for showing us. And just one particular guy stood out in my mind because at the beginning, King had come over and I was like, you need to get Pastor Craig. This is a bad situation. So Pastor Craig came over and kind of diffused the situation. And that last day, that guy, the same man who was very defensive, actually pulled me aside at the very last, when everything was over, and told me thank you. And he brought another guy over and he was like, well, you tell him some of the things that you had said in the group. And that just really... that really touched me, that so much change could happen, and only God can do that. Only God can create that much change. So I'm very thankful to be a part of this.
Well, obviously the people of Mozambique and Maputo are really close to me. Otherwise, I wouldn't go again. This time that we went, the home visit was really special. I just really connected with the family this year, even more than I did last year. I'm not even really sure why, but we cooked so much food. I feel like I handmade way more food than maybe I do. I don't want to tell you in how much time here, but it would be shameful. But we made a lot of food. We walked a whole lot. And they took us on like an adventure of a train ride and what they called a bus that was certainly not a bus and I think was held together by duct tape and a prayer, but was really, really cool. I was literally, there would be like a loud thunk and I'd be like, that's it, the engine is gone and we're walking home, but it wasn't. And it was just a really great time. And one of my favorite parts of the trip, besides the safari was really great this year too, was just the people. God literally just chose each person on this trip and everyone just flowed together. And I've never really been a part of a team that was like that, where it was just everyone made space for each other and no one was trying to be higher than the other. And we just fit together and we were all very silly. This is a picture of someone that I met last year and I was just really excited to see him again. It was really good to make those connections again. But yeah, it was amazing. Absolutely amazing.
Yeah, it's interesting. Every time I go on a mission trip, I always think that I'm going to have like this awesome, I don't know, like this awesome story. And we do have awesome stories, but every time I come back and in the processing for Africa, you have like 16 hours of processing because you have a 16-hour flight. But yeah, every time I go, I think that's like the Lord's going to do something, and it always works out where God gives me this desire to do something there. But then by the time I'm processed through that, He finally gets me to see correctly that, oh, actually what you were doing there, I was just stirring your heart for what I want you to do here. And that's almost every time I've been on a mission trip. It's been that way from the outset. I remember when I went to San Francisco with my friend and I came back and the Lord was like, yeah, all those things you want to do. And I was literally said in my mind, like, I wish I could do that stuff here. And then the Lord was like, you can. And so I just like we had tons of stuff. I love the people of Gabani, and we went on a train ride, and I'll tell you, you guys don't know this, but, and it's really strange, but I have a childhood dream of riding a train in Africa. I don't know why it's a childhood dream, but it got answered on this trip. The bus ride, I think it's the next picture. That's the bus that we were in, okay? There's like, it's like a Honda Odyssey, okay? But not a Honda, like it's like a Honda Odyssey size with about, I don't know, 40 people in it. And so like guys like hanging out the window and hot as can be, but just a wonderful trip and a wonderful time. We ministered to marriages that, honestly, I think I told Pastor Craig before we left, like, I don't know, it's like trying to bite off a lot more than I think we can chew, because when I went last year, I didn't see a single husband, like very few husbands. And so I knew it would be a challenge. And I think the Lord really, really answered that in our time. And so I was grateful for the time there. So, yeah.
Thank you. Would you let this team know you appreciate them and minister? You guys can head down. At this time, I'm going to invite our graduates and those interns right quick. If those are graduates, Pastor King, if you'll come, and Thomas, if you'll come, and Grace as well. We're going to celebrate some graduates. It is graduation season in America. May is always that way, and now it's the first in the beginning of June. And we've got a couple of graduates that we want to recognize. If you'll step up here, that way we can get them right across here. So I know that this church has been so deeply impacted by the interns that have served with DPYA over the last year and a half, now 2 years. We've had two different internships, of which not only their ministry has impacted the young adult ministry, but has really, their integrity and leadership made an indelible impact on the church as a whole. And I know for those of you who serve in different areas would agree and attest to that. So we're going to talk a little bit and just recognize a couple of our interns. But before, we're going to recognize some high school graduates, okay? So let's go do the graduates first.
All right. Luke, you're finally graduating, my man. So we got Luke Schoens graduating from Creekview High School, and he is going to follow in Hannah's footsteps and go to Liberty University doing film production. I know you've connected with our friend Zach on that over the years. It's really special that you're getting to go and study that. And Luke, we're really excited for you. I remember a time when you didn't tower over me, so it's kind of weird looking, kind of strange looking across at you right now. But yeah, man, we're super proud of you and excited for everything you got in your college years. Oh, yes. Also, not on stage with us today, we have Samuel Smith graduating from the Smith Homeschool Academy. So, great job, Jessica. You are best principal in that school. So, yeah, so we're really excited for Samuel, too, and we have a gift for him as well, Jessica.
I get the pleasure of announcing our Stella Girls graduation. So, this is Stella Calvert. She graduated from Sequoia High School. She worked all through high school at Family Traditions, and she was active in chorus. She plans to attend KSU to pursue a career as a psychologist. She changed.
Okay, I'm going to Chat Tech this fall, and I'm going to be a teacher.
There you go. Complete change from last week. I love it, but we're so proud of you. We have a gift for our graduates. It's New Morning Mercies. This was given to me when I graduated high school, and it really helped me in my college journey of, you know, what to read, what to do without being around my normal community. And so we're going to give that to you guys. And we're so excited and so proud of you guys. So here you go, King.
Yeah. Well, we'll start over here with my man, William Bostwick Spencer. William graduated this year. He was in the College of Political Science. He was a KSU College Republican chairman, awarded best chapter in the state of Georgia. Woo! This dude has done so much, and honestly, like, it's been a great pleasure to have him in our ministry and with our people. He's already influencing people that are younger than him and really growing in his leadership, and I'm proud of you. I think the world of you, and I'm so excited for your future. So, and then Riley Lang, she's graduating, bachelor's degree in English and literature. She chartered a pro-life club. This is actually where I met Riley. I met her on the green. She had a cowboy hat on and cowboy boots, and they were doing some pro-life stuff. And I stopped and talked to her, and I didn't even know who I was talking to. I just stopped and talked to her, and very bubbly and just fun to be around. And she's been great for our community. She's extremely passionate about God's design and how he's designed things and how he ministers to hearts. And so I'm grateful for you, and I'm so proud of you and all that you've done, and so grateful. So, and then Tiffany Cook, bachelor's of science and mathematics, minor in applied statistics, all way too many things that way smart, too smart for me. I will tell you, Tiffany came to us. God works so awesomely sometimes, all the time. But Ben Crawford and I started doing ministry on campus together. He came to be a part. I met his then girlfriend, who is his now wife, Grace. And they introduced me to Tiffany, and Tiffany quickly became just a part of our group, and sacrificed her time to help us get an RSO, which is a registered student organization. It's actually pretty difficult to do this, and so she spent a lot of time. And over the last 4 years, that was her freshman year, over the last 4 years, she's continued to serve in that way, so I'm really, really grateful. You've been just an awesome part of our community, and just an honor to serve with you, and so we're so thankful for you. We have a gift. Sorry, one more thing. I have a gift for them as well.
We celebrate these graduates one more time as they head down. And I know we're taking time this morning, but you guys can head down. We're taking time this morning, but we just wanted to be able to celebrate our young people, and I know it's in engagement with young people, we as a church want to commission and believe that God they're not just the church of the future, but the church of today. And so last but not least, we're going to just recognize right quick some interns. Do they have them up here? They ready? Yeah. Right quickly, we're just going to show you some interns. Y'all come up here for those who've been interning. Yeah, come quickly, 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 quickly. Y'all put your hands together for them as they come, all right? This is wonderful. These folks have been faithful. There's 10 of them. I think Jacob Wood's the only one not here, right, because he's out of state. But these are interns that interned not only last year at Dwelling Place Church, but also the ones that are just finishing up this year's internship. And so, Pastor King, you want to give each name?
Yes, yes. So, there's not any room. Excuse me. You're right here. All right, so, I'm so proud of these people. So I'll start with my man Chase Coleman. There's a video, actually, I think, that they're going to play. You can turn you can keep playing the sound. It's no sound. Sorry. So Chase, actually, Chase started this 3 years ago was we started an internship together, just me and him. And then he decided to come into the second year along with Kobe and Dangler and Kat and Anna. And so we had a really good year, but Chase kind of started this thing off, has always been a great, really great friend of mine through all of it. And so I was grateful for him giving me the opportunity to lead him. Next I say would be Dangler. Chase was roommates with Dangler. Dangler was, I guess you could say a self, what's the word I'm looking for? So, sorry. He was atheist or agnostic?
I said more. I lean more at enjoying Taoism.
Okay. There you go. Yeah. but anyway, so Chase had a conversation with him. They were roommates. Chase, we were praying for him, and Dangler came into this community from those prayers and from, you know, the Lord leading him too. But Dangler's been awesome. He's now leading in multiple ways. He leads a ministry on Marietta campus for Dwelling Place, along with Ryan and Cheyenne and Kat. And so really grateful for them this year and all that they've done. Who's next? Anna. Y'all know Anna Capagna? Anna has been awesome. She came with that group also, first group. Now she leads our social media for DP Young Adults. She actually leads almost everything because she helps me in so many ways. And so I'm really grateful for her life. And she's a mentor to many of the young women in our community. She's a great leader. She's a prayer warrior. She's a learner. So I'm just grateful for your life, Anna. Next would be Kobe. Kobe McKeenster. Kobe came to us and out of another church here in Woodstock and was looking for some growth and just leadership development. And so he came to be a part, and so grateful for you, Kobe. And he leads now in DP Students, helps that team, and is, what's that?
Worship team.
Yeah, worship team leader. Obviously, you guys know that. He leads worship here also, and his heart, and again, his ability and gifting to draw people into the presence of God is just amazing. And so grateful for you. The last from that group was Kat Valentinova. Did I say it right? Close. I got it close. Kat's now going to KSU. She's studying to be an architect. But she's also helps with our Marietta campus ministry. And among other things, she leads a lot of our young women. And so I'm really grateful for you too. So then we had the next year that came in, and I'm going to start with my man, Breb. Brennan Morse, known as Breb, known as also from, they all left. The kids call him Mr. B, but just grateful. His heart is huge. If you guys ever get a chance to talk to him, he's a great person to talk to. He'll open up his heart, and so many fun times. Cheyenne was with us this year again. Super gifted, artistic. If you need a mural done at your house, she'll do it for you at a price. And then Kasia, obviously, she's leads worship. She's very gifted in worship, and a great servant of the Lord, super excited about Jesus, very disciplined. And then Ivy. Ivy is leading also in social media and has done an awesome job with that. So really grateful for you guys. I do want to say just like there's really no words really to tell you how proud I am of you and how you guys have moved forward and been diligent in trusting in Jesus. And so I'm just grateful for your lives. So.
Your integrity and leadership has made an indelible impact on this ministry as a whole, and we are deeply, deeply grateful. I want you one more time to put your hands together for them, as that you guys can head down. You guys can head down. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward at this time. I'm going to pray. Know what you're giving to. There's nothing else I need to say. You're giving to a ministry that believes in raising up next-gen leaders to impact the world for Jesus Christ and so much more. So let's pray as we give today. God, thank you for your faithfulness to us. You're so kind to us. And we thank you for this church and what you're doing. We thank you that you are the chief shepherd. And so, Lord, now, even in these moments, I pray, speak to us clear through your word. In Jesus' mighty name.
Lonely, I'm Mr. Lonely. I have nobody for my own. I'm so lonely. I'm Mr. Lonely.
Say it with me, dinner with Jesus. Acts chapter 17, beginning in verse 13. Acts 17, verse 13. Then the priest of Zeus, whose temple was in front of their city, brought oxen and garlands to the gates, intending to sacrifice with the multitudes. But when the apostles Barnabas and Saul heard this, they tore their clothes and ran in among the multitude, crying out and saying, "Men, why are you doing these things? We also are men with the same nature as you, and preach to you that you should turn from these useless things to the living God, who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all things that are in them, who in bygone generations allowed all nations to walk in their own ways. Nevertheless," notice this, "he did not leave himself without witness. And that he did good, gave us rain from heaven in fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. And with these sayings, they could scarcely restrain the multitudes from sacrificing to them." I want to preach a message to you today titled, "Not Without a Witness." Not without a witness. Father, I ask in Jesus' name that you would anoint your word, that Holy Spirit, you would search hearts and minds of those that are open, who are ready to know you, to take their next step, that you would do, Spirit of wisdom and revelation, what only you can do. Reveal Jesus. I yield to you the best I know how. Unashamedly need you, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. I heard recently of a syrup bottle, and it had a warning label on it. And one of the warnings was, keep away from children. But as a person was reading through it, they came to another warning. It said, keep away from tractors. And the person could not reconcile in their mind what could go wrong between a tractor and syrup. And so it come to be that actually the syrup was made in an Arabic country. And that in the Arabic language, the word for tractor is almost identical for the word for heat. The only difference is one dot. if you're familiar with the Arabic language. And here's the point that hit my heart and mind when I heard that story. Translation is not so easy. Communication is not so easy. However, eating and enjoying food, not so hard. There's a lot of people that don't necessarily care for. Not my best friends. But I can get along with them over a good meal. Over a good meal, you can basically seem to find common ground. You know, that's why it's called soul food. It makes you feel good. See, listen to me. God is spirit. God is invisible. But we as mankind, we are material. We are visible. We are spirit, soul, and body. And translating the divine realities into the natural is not so easy. Communication of the spiritual to the natural is not so easy. Sin has interfered greatly. Think of Jesus to Nicodemus. If you're familiar with that story. He makes it clear that talking about the divine realities and the divine and getting humanity that has been greatly affected by sin to understand it is not so easy. What about Paul to the Corinthians? He tells them it's not so easy. We talk about spiritual things and the carnal human mind can't comprehend and understand. And in our main text, there's this statement Paul makes there in Athens. He says, nevertheless, He, God, did not leave Himself without witness, and that He did good. He gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. When it comes to eating in our culture, we eat at tables. Let me talk first today about the witness of the table. Notice we see that Scripture says that at the table there is a witness. At the table when we eat, there is a witness, and it's a witness, what did Paul say? That God has done good. He has done good. He didn't just provide one food. He didn't just provide one type of food. He provided a variety of food. There's all kinds of great options, and we see that at the table, we see that God has been good to mankind. Secondly, He has given the food. He has provided the food. He has provided the rain. He has provided the seasons. Even though the population on the earth has continued to multiply in obedience to God's command in Genesis 1 to be fruitful and multiply, God has continued to give of His rain, to give fruitful seasons. So at the table and at the eating, there is a witness that God has been good to His creation because God has given us food. And then thirdly, He fills us. He fills us with that good food. He fills us with the reality of food and gladness. In fact, the preacher of Ecclesiastes struggles working through the hard complexities of life under the sun and the complexities of justice and injustice and all the things that don't seem to fit of what's happening under the sun. And the preacher, as he struggles through what's happening under the sun, he continually comes back to the point that nothing is better for a person than to eat and drink, that his soul should enjoy good from his labor. That in all the difficulties that the preacher was having to understand the complexities of life that we can observe and the hardships of life, the one staple point the preacher kept coming back to see the reality that God has still done good, even though I don't understand all the difficulties of life, and that He has given us good food and drink, and He fills us with the good food and drink that we should eat and drink. And enjoy what we eat. I still find it amazing every Sunday when I drive past Cane's on Highway 92. that people are still finding it so enjoyable. But there are some people still really loving Cain's. When I surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus after years of dysfunction and deliberate disobedience and my journey of substance abuse, I began to get around Spirit-filled side of Christendom and church expressions. One thing we used to say over a good meal at the table, once you ate something, is this is so good it'll make me speak in tongues. My soul sure does enjoy it. But there is the witness of the table. In the Old Testament, you see this, and Paul ties it in that, yes, there's a lot you can read through the history of mankind, and there's a lot you can observe under the sun and not get it and understand why this happens and that happens and why this happened to that person. But there still is, in all the complexity of life, that the point is that at the table, God is still giving a witness to mankind that he has done good. He has given, and he fills us. If you haven't realized it up to this point, that when you are telling others about the good food you have recently had, you're actually telling them about the witness of God. You don't realize it, but that's what you're doing. Because it's God that gives the rain. It's God that has given the fruitful seasons. And as our main text says, in previous generations, he let people live how they wanted to live, but yet he still gave of his witness even in those generations through the table, through food and drink, and the pleasure of being able to taste the diversity of all the things that God has made and that we can enjoy at the table. The first time we find the actual table in the scriptures is in Genesis with the story of Joseph in Egypt. If you're not familiar with the story of Joseph, it's Joseph is sold into slavery by his brothers and their jealousy and their selfishness and the influence of evil and sin upon them. And the first time we actually see the table in Scripture is Joseph is being reunited with the brothers that sold him into slavery, and he meets the youngest brother that he has never met, Benjamin, in Genesis 43. It says that a table was set for Joseph, and then a separate table was set for his brothers for them to eat. And Joseph's servants had all the brothers in order of age, and they were amazed at what was taking place. After they ate, it says that Joseph was then made known to them after the tables. It's interesting because you get to the New Testament and you get to after Jesus Christ being crucified and died and buried and raised again. And the scripture says that Jesus was made known to two of his disciples in the breaking of bread at the table. Like Joseph was made known to his brothers after the tables. It's interesting to note that the Egyptians, when you go read the story in Genesis 43, the Egyptians could not eat food with the Hebrews, for that was an abomination to the Egyptians. That's why there was tables. That's why Joseph wasn't sitting at the table with his brothers. There was multiple tables set up because Joseph, as being the second in command in Egypt at the time, as an Egyptian, he couldn't sit at the table with the Hebrews, with his brethren. But then the days that Jesus was born in, you find that then the Jews and the Israelites couldn't eat food with the Gentiles and the Egyptians, for they considered it an abomination. What is going on here? What is the story of Scripture and the story of God saying? The Egyptians for a time considered it an abomination to eat with the Hebrews. Then later, the Hebrews, the Jews, considered it an abomination to eat with the Egyptians and all Gentiles. That would be all of us. But then we find within the story of God, the good news of the gospel of Jesus is that God made a way in the New Testament for there to be peace between the two. and to be able to meet and eat together at the table. That God made a way for there no longer to be two tables, but that there's only one table. And Paul writes to the circular letter in Ephesians, in Ephesians 2:14 says, "For he now himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new humanity." One new group of people from the two, thus making peace. For through him, Jesus, we now both, whether Jew or Gentile, have access by one Spirit. The witness of the table was witnessing too that God and Jesus was going to make a way at the table. That despite our differences, and despite how long things have been built up between us, and despite how other people has manipulated and tried to build things between us, there now is only one table in Jesus. One table. That the table that God has prepared in Jesus is greater than any hatred and strife and enmity. Greater than any racism, greater than any mentalities, greater than any devil and any demon, that God has done a work in Jesus where there's one table where any, whosoever will, can be a part of the new humanity, the new people of God. The new people whose now our presence is a prophetic proclamation that there will be a new heavens and a new earth where righteousness will dwell, where justice will flow like a river, where every wrong will be made right, where sin and Satan and evil will be put away, and every tear will be wiped away. We are the prophetic presence declaring that there is a new heaven and a new earth that comes. That's coming. See, God in the beginning first made the heavens and the earth. He made it good, and then he put mankind in the middle. But when mankind went wrong, everything else went wrong. So God said in the new creation, I'm going to first get mankind right. Then I'll make a new heaven and a new earth where they, the righteous people, my people, will dwell. So you see this story from the Old Testament of there being tables to then there being one table. See, listen to me, friend. You maybe never have heard it. You maybe never have had it enlightened to your heart and mind yet by the Spirit of God through the Scriptures. But the story of God is significantly wrapped up in the story of the table. Before the table shows up in the story of Joseph with his brothers, the altar was a table. It was humans placing what is food for us on an altar for our God. Even those that didn't believe in the one true God, they still had altars where they placed what was food for them on the altar for the gods that they worshiped. This is important because this shows how worship is and has always been connected to the table. That's one of the big sins is people that keep cooking but never learn how to cook some good soul food. Stop it. Stop it right now. There's cooking shows on every day. Learn how to cook some food that makes us bless God. We'll have mercy on your past if you'll just start learning now. Shows how worship has always been connected to the table. Paul carries this theme into the New Testament, to the New Testament churches. Whether we eat or drink, do it for the glory of God. And see, the rest of the food that wasn't offered on the altar would then be eaten by the humans. A significant point is that humans, due to sin, consistently missed a major point. Sin so affected our ability to interpret spiritual realities in God who is spirit that we miss for generations and generations a major point. And the major point was this, is there's nothing a human could offer on the altar that God did not first provide for them to offer. Nothing. Well, God, I'm going to offer you this new song. Yeah, we can do it, but the only reason we can offer the new song is because He first gave us breath. God is working towards something. He's working towards a revelation to the hearts and minds of humans and His creation. See, if God was most concerned about humans offering Him something on an altar, then He would not have provided us with food or animals first that could be offered, and He would then have just waited to see what we as humans, as mankind, could create on our own and then offer Him. But God already knows us, His creation. So you move from the altar and you move from the first instance of the table, Joseph and his brothers. Then you come to God seeking to get a representation of what's in the heaven of heavens on earth. And so He gives the pattern for Moses' tabernacle. And then He gives the pattern for Solomon's temple. And in the pattern of Moses' tabernacle and Solomon's temple, there's the table of the showbread in the holy place. And the table of showbread had the bread of His presence placed on the table and the lampstand. And what is God saying? This is speaking again to the witness of God at the table. The witness of God to the souls of us humans, bread and light. The bread is witnessing that God has done good to provide for us humans, that He gives the rain. He is the one that designed for the fruit and the trees and the bountiful harvest to take place. He is the one that gives us our daily bread. And the lampstand gives light. The lampstand gives us a witness. And then God gave witness through His Son in the last days. We just finished last month's series. If you weren't here, we encourage you to go to our web and listen through. But seeing the connection of the Old Testament part of God's story to then the New Covenant, the New Testament part of God's story. But then God now in the last days has given witness through His Son. And in the witness of God through Jesus, we see the altar and the table becoming central again. We see the greater witness of God, for Jesus was a greater witness than the previous witness that God gave every generation of the table. But now you see the greater witness of God through Jesus being at the table of witness that God had ensured throughout all the generations. See, it was all pointing to Jesus being at the table. It was all pointing, witnessing to Jesus being at the table. God planned a greater witness than just some good soul food and some good food. Because God, listen, He desired to get through the interference sin caused in His communication to us, His creation. Jesus was the real bread of God's presence that it came down. Jesus was the real lampstand that gives us light. For as John the Apostle says, He is the light of men and in Him is the life. But today we look around as secularism begins to abound in our nation and in the West. That there are many people that aren't currently interested in the greater witness. They're not interested in Jesus or the name of Jesus or talking about Jesus. Or they're not able to see or hear clearly due to the confusion that sin has caused. And this comes to our main text in Acts, brings us to our main text, Acts 17:13. Then the priests of Zeus, whose temple was in front of the city, brought oxen and garlands to the gates, intending to sacrifice with the multitudes. But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes and ran in among the multitude, crying out and saying, "Men, why are you doing these things? We also are men with the same nature as you, and preach to you that you should turn from these useless things to the living God, who made heaven, the earth, the sea, and all things that are in them, who in bygone generations allowed all nations to walk in their own ways. Nevertheless, he did not leave himself without witness, and that he did good. He gave us rain from heaven in fruitful seasons, and he filled our hearts with food and gladness." And with these sayings, they could scarcely restrain the multitude from sacrificing to them. Notice that, nevertheless. People were walking in their own ways. Today, people walk in their own ways. They walk in their own desires. They walk in their own imaginations of their heart. They walk in their own dictionary. They walk how they want to walk. Nevertheless, God is not wanting to leave himself without a witness. Amen. And our prayer and our charge this month is that your table would not exist without it being a witness. That your table would bear witness to God, to at least one around you, one coworker, one neighbor, one household around you. This brings us to the significance of the table. I couldn't see earlier. I just saw you. Happy birthday, Bethany Monroe, by the way. The significance of the table. Did you know Jezebel had a table? Do you know false gods have a table? Do you know Solomon had a table? King David had a table? Did you know the devil has a table? But the Lord of glory, Jesus, has a table. In 1 Corinthians 10:21, it says, "You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the Lord's table and the table of demons. Just notice the point is that the devil has a table, but Jesus Christ, the King, has a table. Let me talk about the King's table, the real King, Jesus, for a moment. The table of the Lord. The table of the Lord is a witness of God's existence. Jesus came to be the greatest witness and display of the invisible God, of God who is spirit, of God who can't be seen with natural eyes. The table of the Lord is also the witness of God's goodness. Jesus went about doing good and healing all who were sick and oppressed of the devil, for God was with him, Acts 10:38. The table of the Lord is witness of God's provision. When you think about the table of the Lord, it's witnessing that God is able to provide for his people, for his creation. He can provide by through his wisdom. He can provide by his authority. He could provide by his power. But the table of the Lord is also about the witness of God's intention. Why did God do all this? If there's so much heartache, if there's so many tears, if there's so much oppression under the sun, if there's so much that don't make sense, if there's so much that doesn't seem to fit and line up, then why would God do this? What is his intent? Mark 7:24, amazing story, hits us all. It says, "From there he arose and he went to the region of Tyre and Sidon, and he entered a house and wanted no one to know it, but he could not be hidden. For a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit," that's a demon, "heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet." The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. But Jesus said, "Let the children be filled first. for it is not good to take the children's bread and to throw it to little dogs. She answered and said to him, yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs. Then he said to her, for this saying, go your way. The demon has gone out of your daughter. And when she had come to her house, she found the demon gone out and her daughter lying on the bed. What's going on? She answers and says, yes, Lord, but even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs. See, the God in the old covenant provided a way for there to be a table for Israel. Because remember, the table speaks to provisions. And you go read through the law, there's some provisions. There's some promises that God would do certain things for them in the covenant. But it was only for the covenant people, the people in covenant. That God would use his authority and power and influence for the people in covenant with him. But it was the Jewish nation that he chose who were small and weak and despised. And he grew them to display his glory through them. But one comes to him and she's outside of the covenant because she's not born into the Hebrews. And Scripture makes it very clear that when Jesus came, he came first to the old covenant people who had lost their way, who had missed the intent of God, who had created so much harm and heartache, even as God's old covenant people. And it says he was sent to the Jews first. Even when Jesus raised up the 12 and raised up the 70 and sent them out, he said, don't go into the way of the Gentiles. But Scripture prophesied that even Jesus ministered to the Jews would be a light to the Gentiles. And this woman saw the light. She saw the light. She saw the intent of God, that the intent of God was not to keep people separated by birth or how, where you were born or what color of skin you were born in, what ethnic group you were born in. She saw the intent of God. She saw the greater witness in Jesus, and she comes and Jesus challenges the cultural tension to see if she would allow what others and the racism and the division of multiple tables in the community and in the region that she grew up in keep her from relational trust of God's real intent for her and all mankind. Yes. And she said, oh, but even the little dogs eat the crumbs. My wife, she does well keeping a clean house. She loves really a clean kitchen and she cleans it often. And I just don't understand when I hear her yelling and I go in there and she's yelling at the dog. The dog has picked up her desire to have a clean kitchen because he's moved from just eating the crumbs to now going around in a design licking the floor. And she yells at him. I just thought he's just trying to help her. She finds it disgusting. She yells at him, you're going to make me have to clean more. But here's the intent. She sees it. Listen, and here's what's breaking through in this story. The intent of God is, listen, the Lord's table is more about relationship than anything else. See, I don't know about you, but I do different things at the table than just eat. In my family, we play games at the table. My family of upbringing, so my you know, close-knit family, we play cards at the table every time we're together. There's people that do business transactions at the table. I believe when I read the story of Home Depot, it tells how, Arthur Blank owns Home Depot and the Atlanta Falcons, how even he threw a napkin, slid across the table to buy the Atlanta Falcons. Business transactions. And the point is this, listen, God does care about business and he cares about, you know, fun things and things like that. But here's the intent of God. Listen. Above everything else, what matters most is relationship. God is wanting to relate to you and I and to mankind. At the end of the day, God cares more about my relationship with him than the businesses I try to do for him. He wants relationship. Relationship above all else. And he wants it with you. And the work of the Holy Spirit is that you would get to a place to see the way that God witnesses, to be like this Phoenician woman who culturally was on the outside, who culturally could have taken the norms and said, no, you know, God doesn't want me. He doesn't want to help my family. He doesn't want a relationship with me. And did not allow any of all of the chaos breed doubt, unbelief, bitterness, anger, turmoil to keep her from experiencing the intent of Jesus. Even when the timing wasn't aligned. Here's the point. Listen to me. I don't know who it's for, but I know it's for more than me. But God prophetically spoke to me in a dream this week. And He said, I care more about you than even covenant of right and wrong. There are people who think that God cares most about whether you're doing right or doing wrong. No, no. What God cares above everything, and that's ultimately what the table and the witness of the table was leading to through Jesus being at the table, is He wants you. He wants you. That's His intent. His care and love and seeking heart for you is for you above any right you've done or even wrong you've done. And you see it breaking in throughout the story of Scripture until we get the full picture of all the new covenant, but that God cares about you more than even the rules and the laws that He placed in covenants. So in this series, we're looking at the question, dinner with Jesus, or the statement. And when I thought about what dinner with Jesus would be like, I can ultimately tell you with the big question mark, I don't know exactly. I don't know exactly what dinner with Jesus would be, but here's what I do know. Luke 22, 27. For who is greater? He who sits at the table or he who serves? It is not he who sits at the table, yet I am among you as the one who serves. I don't know all that would happen if you had dinner with Jesus or I had dinner with Jesus, but the one thing I do know is at dinner with Jesus, He would be seeking to serve you. To serve you with God's original intent for you. To break through the questions and the madness and the division and the division of your own heart about why you exist. And Jesus would be seeking to serve you and witness to you that God wants you. He wants you. He wants you way more than you trying to keep score of right and wrong. He wants you. He would seek to serve you in a way regarding God's purpose for you. He would be seeking to witness that you would allow the Holy Spirit to reveal this to you more than just words, but an experience of the depth and substance of these words. That I do not ask you to offer something on the altar. I put myself on the altar for you. He would be seeking to witness to that. That I'm not waiting on you to build something for me, to accomplish something for me, to do a good work for me, to prove yourself for me. I put myself on the altar for you. I'm not waiting or asking for you to offer something to me. I want you to get the revelation, the witness that I offered myself for you. Because that's the intent of your Creator for you. So then the question I come to is, well, then how does the Lord serve? Real quickly, four things. He serves consistently. Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He serves consistently. Secondly, in an accessible way. In Matthew 9 and 10, it says, "Now it happened as Jesus sat at the table in the house that, behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and sat down with him." It didn't say that he reached out to them or sent an invite to them or he went and knocked and said, "Hey, I'm going to be over here eating. You can come later." But they heard he was in the house and at the table. The ultimate greater witness was at the witness of the table that God had throughout the generations. And they came to him and he was accessible to those that were seeking, to those that came to him. He's accessible. The table of the Lord is accessible. This is the good news of the gospel. Whosoever will, come. Come and eat. Come and drink. Stop trying to prepare a table for God. God made a way through Christ to put himself on the table for you. Scandalous. Offensive. He's supposed to be God. Yeah, but any idea of God that's not full of loving intent for his creation is not the real God. Any idea of a God that would create mankind and then have no care for us and no intent for us is not the real God. Thirdly, how does he serve? He serves personally. He knows you. He knows your story. Listen, he's not, listen to me, he's not comparing you to others because we all don't start at the same place. He knows exactly where you started, in the home you started, where you started, what you've been through, and he knows how to personally serve you in the story that you've experienced. He knows how to be the Word of God to you. To your hurt, to your pain, to your experiences, to your celebrations, to your dysfunctions. Luke 7:37, then one of the Pharisees asked him, "Come on, Keys, to eat with him." And he went to the Pharisee's house and he sat down to eat. And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil and stood at his feet behind him weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with fragrant oil. Here's the point. He's got personal redemption for you. He's got personal healing for you. He's got personal restoration for you. Fourthly, how does the Lord serve? He serves as a Savior. He serves as a Savior. And you know why? Because you and I have something we need to be saved from. All of us. The table of the Lord is a place where we understand we all need a Savior that will save us. My dysfunction, the way it manifests, might be different than the way your dysfunction manifests. But we all need a Savior from our sin, from our selfishness, from Satan and his kingdom. Luke 7:49, and those who sat at the table with him began to say to themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" His name is Jesus. And he has the ability to forgive and release you from your sins, from your debts, from your shame, from your guilt, from thinking that the intent of God is to keep track of just the right and wrongs you do, though as his tent is he's for you. And the story breaks in so scandalous that above even right and wrong, God doesn't allow what's right and wrong to stop him from you. He didn't allow the law that testified to our wrongness stop him from coming in Jesus and coming after us and coming after you. Yet while we were still sinners, Christ died. And there, the cross became an altar.
But it wasn't us offering things to God. It was God in Christ making a way to offer himself for you and I. Because what could you and I ever give him when all that we have comes from him? We give him the hand clap of praise, but it's him that gave us the ability to do that. We're just always giving back to him what he in his goodness has only given us. For what can we give that we've not received? What can we glory in that didn't come from the glorious one? So the question we've asked in this church community multiple times throughout the years, and some of you have not been there, and I'll go into the depth of one thing, is the question, will you let God love you in Jesus? See, some of you right now, the problem is you refuse to let God love you in Jesus. No. Love you right now. With the questions you have right now, with the hurt you have right now, with the addictions you have right now, with the inner turmoil right now. Will you let God love you in Jesus right now? Right now. But today, then, that leads to the question, will you let God serve you in Jesus? Some of us has let God love us in Jesus, but now some of us are, we're still stuck because we're trying to serve God. And I'm going to tell you that in this series, when we talk about the witness that God wants at the table, in the table of your home, it will never be the greatest witness he can do at the table if you don't let him first serve you. The people you experience the love of God through the most is the people who let God love them the most in their brokenness, in the brokenness of their story. Who, through relational trust, allows the scandalous message to break through of just living from right and wrong and lets God just love them, lets the intent of God just fill them. Well, it's the same. Those that's actually to serve the most effective are those who first allow God through Jesus to first serve them. And we are like Peter. There's Peters in this room. Lord, how dare you? You will not touch my feet. You know how nasty my feet are? I got toe fungus. Lord, you can't touch my toe fungus. Lord, I got to keep that covered up. I don't even want people to know I have toe fungus. And he says, then you have no part with me, Peter. You have no part in what I'm doing. And the ministry and how the scandalous message of grace and his love and his ability for you and I, how it expands. Because it don't expand just through right and wrong living. It expands through a revelation. A revelation, and yes, there's been a lot of sin and a lot of the work of the devil that's tried to mix up the communication of God, who is Spirit and his love and his intent for us. But he says, Peter, you got to let me wash your feet or you have no part. But I, Lord, should be washing your feet. No. I got to wash your feet. For there's nothing you and I have to offer that didn't first come from him. How freeing. And you know what's amazing about freeing is that free people are actually excited about the message. Message of right and wrong, not so much. Because it steals our lunch. It steals the witness of the table. It's constantly witnessing that, yes, there are still things in me that are not right. That the farther I follow Jesus, I think I am like better, but the more I follow him, the more he shows me the brokenness of my past. The more he shows me inability. And time again, like we sang, I get a glimpse of his glory in the day that I'm in the season I'm in, and it leads to fresh worship. That our worship doesn't just have to be based on a past glimpse. God's got a new glimpse from you at the witness of the table. Some of you are still trying to offer and serve in a way like God didn't first provide that to you. That God didn't, some of you are carrying so much weight in your business and finances and marriage and all the things, and you're carrying so much weight because you're forgetting that God first provided you what was needed for those things to even be possible. So let Him then serve you with His strength, His joy. Come on, man. God in Christ, listen, put Himself on the altar. God in Christ put Himself on the table, the cross, for you and I. Saying God wants you. He wants a relationship with you. He cares more about you than right and wrong. And there are things that only Jesus can be to you. Listen to me, no pastor can be. Even Jesus is a model of leadership, but there are things that we, even as leaders, can't model. Only Jesus can be that to you. Only He can be a personal Savior. Only He can be now in the Spirit 100% accessible to you. Jesus in the days of His flesh wasn't 100% accessible to people. He couldn't. He's a human like you and me. You can't be 100% accessible to anyone. But now He's 100% accessible to you because now through the working of the Holy Spirit. So will you let Him serve you? But then how do you let Jesus serve you? You got to answer that. Is it setting time in the morning where you just, before you do anything, you have ways through prayer or reminder or scripture reading to let the grace, gospel, message of Jesus remind and wash over you? That today you really ultimately aren't just serving God as if you're creating and serving Him with something He didn't first give you. So let Him serve and help you in what you're presenting back to Him. I believe God can do miracles in neighborhoods and streets and homes this month. Through the witness of the table. And the witness of the table, now having a greater witness, where actually your life and your table witnesses to neighbors, to coworkers. That we don't have all the answers. And like the people in Athens wanted to worship Paul and offer to him, and he said, we have the same nature as you. That they can see that Jesus people hurt too. Jesus people cry tears too. There's Jesus people going through cancer too. There's Jesus people that have been divorced too. And the neighbors hear a witness in a way where sin and politics and things have tried to distort and divide them from the ultimate reality that God's main intent is He's after them. And just like that syrup bottle that was only missing one dot where it got translated, tractor. Instead of heat, maybe there's some neighbors that's just one dot away, one witness away from getting the right translation of God, their Creator's intent for them through Jesus. And shame broken, dysfunction broken, sin broken, and they know the revelation of God's love and His serving intent to save whosoever will at His table. With every head bowed, every eye closed, you're here today and you need God to be God. And you need Jesus to be Jesus. You need Him to be the one that forgives the sinner. Because you're a sinner. And you're trapped in some sins, or you're trapped in selfishness. And you want Jesus to be Lord and to cleanse and save you. If that's you, I'm not going to embarrass you, but if you'll raise your hand, I want to pray for you. Anyone, Jesus. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Maybe you're here today and Jesus is Lord and leader of your life, but you're asking the Holy Spirit to help you to pull down the walls of self-sufficiency, to pull down the walls and the lies of the enemy, that you have something to offer on the altar and to let Christ crucified be enough. And from that place of revelation and rest, His strength and power will be displayed through you in a greater measure as a witness in the days to come. If that's you and the Lord speaking to you, let me see your hand. I want to pray for you. Yes. Mole, yes. Hands all over. Father, Lord, I ask King Jesus, be King in hearts, cleanse by your Holy Spirit. Fill lives today. Wash away sin and guilt, loose from bondages and addictions and dysfunctions in Jesus' name. Lord, for those that's struggling with self-sufficiency, those struggling with performance orientation, God, thanking, Lord, that they ultimately have something that originates in them to offer you. That, Lord, those lies, those chains, that burden, Lord, would break in Jesus' name. That Holy Spirit, you would enlighten hearts. That the altar of the cross and the power of His resurrection is enough. That Holy Spirit, you would bring life in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let's stand to our feet. Team, lead us. Come on, we don't have long, but why don't you close your eyes and real intently share, confess, be open, just talk. Just like you would talk to your friend, talk to God. Just tell Him. Ask for His help. Go on, ask for a revelation of His love. Ask for a revelation of how He wants to help you. Come on out. our helper to stay maintaining focus on the one table, the table of the Lord, the unity in the Lord. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Hallelujah. Well, you're not dismissed, but you are sent. God bless you as you go.